Chapter 8. In this chapter, we study the most basic type of function, namely linear functions. Let's start by looking at example 8.1. Suppose the present amount of some substance is 56 grams, and the amount 2 weeks later is down to 44 grams. There are two variables in this situation, time and amount. We're going to let t represent the time variable, so it will represent weeks since the present, and we're going to let a represent the amount of substance in grams. So we're going to create a function that relates the two variables t and a. Remember that every function has an input variable and an output variable. Since the amount of substance remaining depends on time, time t will be our input, and a, our amount remaining, that will be our output. And we are going to try and determine an equation that relates these two variables. So let's start by looking at part A. Let's first of all determine the average rate of change in the amount of substance, in other words, delta A over delta T, over this 2 week period. Well, if you recall, the average rate of change in a quantity is the change in the output divided by the change in the input. Well, in this case, it would be the change in the amount, A, over the change in time, which is why you see this fraction over here. So let's go ahead and calculate this fraction. The change in the amount. Well, how much did the amount change? It changed from 56 grams down to 44 grams. So over this 2 week period, we lost 12 grams. Since there was a loss, we indicate that with a negative, 12 grams. Now, the change in time. This is the same as the amount of time that elapsed, and that was 2 weeks in this case. So, we have 2 weeks. So we're taking our total drop of 12 grams, and we're dividing it over the 2 week period that it took to drop that amount. When we divide, we end up with, of course, a negative 6. Negative 6 grams per week. So, over this 2 week period, we lost an average of 6 grams of substance each week. Let's go ahead and look at part B. Now, assuming that this rate of change is constant over any time period, not just the 2 week period that we were talking about above, let's go ahead and complete the following table. I'm going to go ahead and make one change, or two changes in the table. Let's not do this for time 2 and time t, but rather let's do this for time 4 and time 7 instead. So now let's go ahead and complete this table. Time 0 refers to the initial time, and which we can think of as the present time. And at the present time, there are 56 grams of substance. 1 week later, when t is 1, we would expect to have lost 6 grams. So we should be down then to 50 grams. How about 4 weeks later, when t is 4? Well, we started with 56 grams, and we're losing an average of 6 grams a week. So we might expect, over 4 weeks, to have lost 4 times 6, or 24 grams. So the amount remaining should be 56 minus the 24 that we lost. 56 minus 24 is 32. How about after 7 weeks? Well, again, we started with 56 grams, and how much did we lose? Well, we lost 6 grams a week, on average, for 7 weeks. So we would have expected to have lost approximately 42 grams of substance. So the amount remaining would be 56 minus 42, which is 14 grams. Okay, let's look at part C. Again, assuming that the rate of change is constant, write the equation of a function that will calculate the amount of substance remaining at any time. Well, we can go back to our table for assistance here. We calculated the amount remaining at some very particular times, but what if my time was t instead? How would I calculate the amount remaining? Well, we can do it the very same way. I started off with 56 grams, and then we need to subtract off how much was lost. Now, in this case, we're losing 6 grams a week, and if we're going out to t weeks, then we will have lost 6 t grams. So 56 minus 6 t should give us the amount remaining, which is A. Okay, let's have a look at part D. Draw a graph of this function on the axes provided. Okay, well, we started with 56 grams of substance. If we go out 1 week, we lose 6 grams. That brings us down to 50. If I go out another week, we lose another 6 grams, which brings us down to 44. If we go out another week, we lose another 6 grams, bringing us down to 38. We'll do this one more time. If we go out one more week, we drop another 6 grams, which brings us down to 32. And we can continue this trend. If we connect the dots, we see that we arrive at a straight line. The slope of this line remember, is the change in output or the change in input. And in this case, that's negative 6. That's our drop each time we go 1 unit to the right. So our slope is negative 6. And as you'll recall from an earlier screencast, that is always the same as our rate of change. Okay, now let's have a look at part E. Your function equation has the form y equals mx plus b, where x represents the input variable and y represents the output variable. In your function, what are the values of m and b? Well, first of all, recall that our equation was a equals 56 minus 6t. Well, this equation can be written in a slightly different form that makes it easier for us to compare it with this equation, y equals mx plus b. So, first of all, let's rewrite the equation as 56 plus a negative 6t. Now I have two quantities that are added, and now I can just switch the order in which they are added. So we have the equation A equals negative 6 times t plus 56. And we want to compare that to the equation y equals mx plus b. Well, you can see now that the y corresponds to the A, the negative 6 corresponds to the m, the t corresponds to the x, and the 56 corresponds to the b. So in our function, m is negative 6 and b is 56. Before going on, Let's take a moment and talk about what M and B represent in terms of the graph in part D. Well, recall that the negative 6 was the slope, or the rate of change, for this function. That corresponds to the m. So the m in the equation, the m in this equation, represents the rate of change, or the slope. The b was 56. Well, if we look at our graph, the 56 corresponded to our initial amount of substance, and because it was the initial amount, it's also an intercept. So it's also our A-intercept. In other words, the graph crosses the A-axis at 56. So 56 is both an A-intercept and it's also our initial amount. So the B that's in this equation, you can think of it as either a vertical intercept for your graph, or you can think of it as an initial amount. Okay, so let's go ahead and summarize everything that we've learned from the last example and generalize it. A linear function is a function whose outputs grow or decay with a constant rate of change, like what we were assuming in the last example. Linear functions have equations of this form, y equals f at x equals mx plus b, where x represents the input variable and y represents the output variable, or the dependent variable. The letter m represents the constant rate of change of the output variable with respect to the input variable x. In other words, m is the ratio of the change in output y to the change in the input x. We call this the rate of change of y with respect to x, and it is the same as the slope of this line. The letter b represents the y-intercept, or the vertical intercept. Also remember, you can think of it as the initial amount. Because linear functions have a constant rate of change, or a constant slope, the graphs of linear functions are straight lines. So shown below are two lines. Notice that in both cases the y-intercept is b. It's the same b as in the formula here. So b is always that y-intercept. The graph has an upward trend like this when the rate of change, or the slope, is positive, and the graph will have a downward trend, or a decreasing trend, when the slope, or the rate of change, is negative.